Hey guys, Level Cap here, and today I want to talk about live service games and how their unlock economy fundamentally changes the way gamers play games. Now, the live service versus non-live service debate has been raging for quite a while, and some of you might be wondering, what the heck am I even talking about, or what do you mean by a live service game? Well, live service games, aka games as a service, are essentially any game that produces game content continually as part of its revenue model. This was first popularized with MMORPGs, as these games were designed to essentially provide endless content. Heck, the original EverQuest is still getting content, and that game launched in 1999. It's a really cool concept that, in theory, can allow for an endless amount of content for any game, provided that there's an active player base. Now, since the late 90s, the game industry has really refined and perfected live service gaming to maximize player engagement, which is also known as player retention. In an ideal world, player retention would largely be controlled by how immersive or fun a game is. Game could be. However, creating truly fun and immersive games is extremely difficult. In fact, it's far easier to create a moderately fun game and then just cram it full of a reward system designed to trigger a dopamine response every few minutes to keep players hooked. This reward system is now used widely and even expected in the majority of modern gaming. Call of Duty Modern Warfare keeps generating rewards like weapon unlocks, rank ups, and new skins the more you play. Most games now have daily assignments, often referred to as dailies, that allow players to accomplish simple goals for decent rewards once or several times per day. Battlefield has used this system. And then, of course, there's things like timed events that often provide big rewards in exchange for a lot of gameplay within a certain period of time. World of Warships took this to the max with the infamous Puerto Rico grind that required bailing on life to unlock a quote-unquote free ship. Now, the problem, of course, is that these live service systems are effective. So effective that many players, in fact, I would argue the core player base, would prefer to complete mundane assignments for their rewards than actually play games in a fun, competitive, or creative manner. So much of the appeal in games today is tied into how replayable their content is. Pretty much every live service game like PUBG, Battlefield 5, Destiny 2, or Apex Legends is focused on drip-feeding unlocks driven by competitive challenges. Do activity A in location B to unlock C. And these reward systems often just become the gameplay loop itself. It used to be that progressing your skills and abilities as a player in-game was the reward. The better you got, the more you enjoyed the game and the more you wanted to play it. Now developers are augmenting that by creating challenges that push us to play games in weird ways to extend their shelf life and appeal. It's almost like games aren't satisfying anymore unless we have to go out of our way to get new stuff. Apex Legends, for example, locks a ton of its Battle Pass XP behind daily and weekly challenges. While some of them are pretty general stuff, like get X number of kills in a match, many of them are much more specific. Get X kills with this hero, down X players with that hero, use this type of gun to get kills, etc. Min-maxing your XP becomes part of the ritual of queuing up for a match in Apex, as you have to constantly keep in mind which hero or weapon you need to grind with. And before I start to sound like a curmudgeon-y old man talking about how back in my day, gamers used to play games for fun, I will say this. Gaming is better than it has ever been. Cheaper than it's ever been, and more accessible than it's ever been. So, by any measure, gaming is 100 times better than it was in the 90s and early 2000s. That being said, it's not hard to see how so many modern titles are sabotaging their own gameplay with poorly designed live service systems. And the more I think about it, the growing anti-live service sentiment doesn't seem to be based on the fact that live service exists, but rather on how it's implemented. One of the things I repeatedly slammed Battlefield 5 for over its lifetime was the poorly crafted assignment system. Now, Battlefield 5 is a particularly egregious example of live service systems gone wrong, but most games have some form of this. Battlefield 5's example is just really easy to see how a system designed to give players frequent rewards ends up hampering not only the fun of the game, but also the way the core player base plays the game. An assignment in Battlefield 5 might read, "Get 10 headshot kills while in an objective area in one round." The problem with this assignment was multifaceted. Often, it was linked to using a weapon not designed to get headshots, or rather, one that was bad at finishing players with a headshot. So effectively, you had to get lucky most of the time to get a headshot kill. The second part of the problem was that it had to be done in a specific part of a map that may or may not be tactically relevant to the battle. So instead of looking at the map and deciding where you might be super useful, you instead try to figure out where you're most likely to complete this assignment. Then you actively avoid doing anything that could possibly jeopardize your assignment, as you have to accomplish the requirements in a single match. There's no room for error, so don't do things like help teammates or play in a useful manner. This problem became blatantly obvious in Battlefield when new assignments would come out and you could see everyone on your team using the same weapons to try and complete the assignment, or everyone focusing on throwing grenades only because you had to get grenade kills that day. Entire matches would turn into grind fests instead of people playing the game in the manner that it was intended to be played. And Battlefield is certainly not the only game that suffers from this problem, but this is a more extreme example of live service content being implemented to a disastrous effect on the gameplay. But in my opinion, the subtle examples can be quite bad as well, because they're less apparent but often equally harmful to players playing as intended. Take Call of Duty Modern Warfare. The most recent weapon added to the game, the Bruin MK9, required getting 3 kills near a smoke grenade in 15 separate matches with an LMG just to unlock it. I can't even imagine how hard this would be to accomplish for players not spending any money on the game. I completed it by playing Shipment 24/7 because that was the fastest way of doing it, but it was a pretty awful experience as far as actually playing the game is concerned. It was basically 2 days of constant explosions, killstreaks, deaths, and more smoke grenades. Instead of moving around tactically and switching kits to best suit the situation at hand, it was just spamming smoke grenades and LMG to the point where I was just yelling at my screen. Then of course there's the FOMO approach to live service, the fear of missing out. Timed content that you can unlock, but you have to do it in a certain time period. I think possibly one of the worst examples of this, maybe ever, was the Puerto Rico event for the World of Warships game. I know it's not a game that a lot of shooter fans play, but bear with me on this because it's absolutely nuts. Leading into holiday season, the World of Warships developers released a free ship event to unlock a top-tier cruiser called the Puerto Rico. Now, if you play World of Warships, you would know that a premium top-tier ship can cost a lot of money, so the idea that you can get one for free is extremely tantalizing. The problem, of course, was that the assignments you needed to complete in order to unlock the ship were so extensive that you physically couldn't do it unless you played for hours and hours and hours every day for like a month straight. Mind you, this was leading into the holiday season, so if you were looking forward to spending some time with the fam, well, too bad. That sweet ship wasn't gonna let them get in the way. Naturally, there are all kinds of little pay-to-advance mechanics built in to try and squeeze money out of players who bit off more than they can chew. I remember getting a message from one of my friends saying that they were done with the game forever after putting in 10 days straight to the assignment and then realizing that it was virtually impossible to complete, leaving them with essentially nothing except for 10 days of grueling grinding. And the sad thing is, I like World of Warships. The gameplay is fun as heck when it's not being undermined by its aggressive live service system. Gamers used to pay some money, play a game that was fun, and not worry about much else. Now it's often play the game for free but constantly have FOMO or assignments getting in the way of just playing for fun. Of course, many games don't require participation in a lot of the live service content. Like, I didn't have to grind for the Puerto Rico, but it's hard not to when the reward is so big and you're a dedicated player. In fact, the core players, in my opinion, seem to be affected by live service content the most. Casual players probably don't care that much, since they're not that invested in getting top competitive gear, and instead just want a fun match from time to time. Whales, aka the people who just buy all the microtransaction content, usually people with spending problems and not trust fund kids like the developers would want you to believe, manage to avoid a lot of the live service assignments by buying their way around them. Granted, that's a whole problem on its own, with developers preying on people with addictive tendencies. So with casual players and whales not being as affected by the gameplay burdens of a live service system, that really just leaves the core player base left to deal with all of these live service assignments and engage in that content. Now, it's not to say that all games with live service content are bad or implement them in ways that affect gameplay negatively. And despite Counter-Strike's history with basically creating a gambling system associated with its skin market, the gameplay in Counter-Strike isn't really affected by loot crates and whatnot. For the most part, they're just awarded somewhat randomly, and you can increase your odds by doing better in a match, which just means playing the game as best as you possibly can. So there's games that don't really cannibalize the gameplay for the sake of unlocks. It can be done right and it can be done better, but many of the top tier games these days are really sacrificing their gameplay for the sake of microtransactions and live service content. And these poorly implemented live service games are really what fuel the fire for the anti-live service arguments out there. The problem is that live service just isn't going away. It's far too profitable and far too effective. I think gamers are ultimately going to have to accept that to an extent, but what we should be really pushing back against is poorly implemented live service content like Call of Duty or Battlefield that fundamentally change the motivations of how people play a game from having fun to trying to get an unlock. And that's really where the problem lies with live service content. Hopefully developers can wrap their heads around some better ideas for implementation in the future, but really the strongest thing in the game industry is money, right? Money talks. If these techniques are very effective and they've already got big, healthy player bases, it's hard to see them making a big change when the system is working for them. Anyway, I think it's a really interesting topic. Let me know what you guys think about live service games and the way they're implemented, what you would like to see from games in the future, or how you'd like them to change their live service content, if at all. And I'll see you guys next time. This is Level Cap, signing off.